Hello and welcome to The Two Show with me, Tone.
And me, Bailey.
And today, we are broadcasting from a very grand living room in the marvellous county of Surrey again.
Grand is an understatement.
Well, and today we've got a very, very special guest on our show who has a very successful career in not only music, but also in astrophysics and conservation.
Ladies and gentlemen, give it up for Brian May.
Brian May.
Thank you very much. That's a wonderful round of applause. Thank you very much. And welcome to my humble abode.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Indeed. And what a grand setting this is to do this fantastic programme. So first of all, we're going to talk about your music and the success that you've had within it. So earlier this year, you won with Adam Lambert, who is very, very good, Band of the Year at the Classic Rock Roll of Honour Awards. How do you feel about awards like this at this stage of your career?
I feel very happy because it's a sign that people still care about us, I suppose, and it's very gratifying for us to see that our music spans generations. So we have everyone from sort of 95 down to about 5. And actually, that award was last year. We just got another award from Classic Rock, which was for Living Legends.
Oh.
So I feel very happy about that, to be a living legend. And when I got up to do my speech, I said, well, I'm really, really happy that I'm living to start off with. You know, I'm probably grateful enough for that. But to be a legend as well is very nice. And yes, it means a lot. That's the answer. You know, it does, because music is a conversation in a way. Music is communication. And if one side isn't listening, then you're wasting your time. So it's a sign for us that people are listening and people care and people still love us. So we still love them.
Yes.
Very good.
So what about the other side?
The other side? Astronomy?
Ah, yes. Well, we'll go into that later. So we mentioned Adam Lambert being on tour with you. So how do you find Adam Lambert? I mean, does he make a change for the new era of Queen and Adam Lambert?
Yeah, it's amazing. I mean, he is, in a sense, new blood in the correct sense of the word. He's a phenomenon. He's a phenomenal singer. And I say this without any sort of scrap of hesitation, because you do not find a voice like that in a million people. So and if we'd looked for a voice like that, we probably wouldn't have found it. It's just an amazing, I call him the GFG. The gift from God, because, you know, we didn't look for him, and suddenly from the skies comes this guy who can sing all of our songs. Now, our songs are very difficult to sing because they have a lot of range to them.
Yeah.
And require a lot of range of passion and sound and expression and everything as well. Now, Adam is totally up to all of it, and he has more than enough range and more than enough personality. He also has those magic things, which are, I guess you would call it charisma, but we would probably call it contact with the audience. He has the ability to actually reach out and touch people. So in the concerts, you can see it happen. You can see this chemistry. The first couple of numbers, they're looking at him and thinking, well, you know, you're not Freddie and we love Queen, but is this going to work? About halfway through the third number, there is not a soul in the place that isn't eating out of his hand. And you can just see it. They fall in love with him and they get it and they realise that he's not in any way a copy of Freddie, but he can deliver the kind of spirit which we embody, and it works.
Yeah. I must say I agree with that. I saw your New Year's Eve concert, I think, and I got that, like, that sense of how brilliantly he was performing and, well, just how well it fitted with the theme of a new era, a new year.
Yeah, the New Year's Eve concert was great because those such things like that are incredibly high anxiety, shall I say?
Mm.
You know, I mean, we hadn't done that many concerts with him at that point. It was all still quite new. We'd done iHeart in America and a couple of other things, but that was quite early days for us and Adam. And if you saw him now with us, like, for instance, if you see us at the Isle of Wight Festival next summer, you'll see something a little different probably, because he's grown and I think we've grown. And the whole thing has reached another level. So, but that concert was a phenomenal thing because it's totally live. I mean, even the BBC technicians were looking at us and saying, well, are you really doing this live? You know, there's no clicks, there's no backing tracks, there's no hard disk. And we went, no, that's what we do. We do live. And it's a great thing. There's nothing quite like it. There's a danger there's a spontaneity, and everybody gets it. Everybody gets that feeling. And of course, we're working to the clock, which adds another dimension of kind of pressure, because you have to finish it exactly at the spot where the Big Ben thing is going to happen, and then you start up again afterwards. And I think we love it. I think we love that adrenaline flow. We love the challenge of delivering something extraordinary when there's no safety net. I mean, in a sense, I think we look for it. You know, it's part of what we are. I mean, me on top of the roof of Buckingham Palace is another example. There was no safety net there. It was utterly live and horrendously dangerous. And I would have looked the biggest idiot in the world if I'd screwed up on top of Buckingham Palace in front of a billion people.
But you don't screw up on top of Buckingham Palace, do you?
Well, you could do. You very easily could. There was a number... I mean, I don't know if you can imagine, but the amount of fear you face is very kind of character-forming. It's not fear of falling off the roof. It's fear of making an idiot of yourself, because everybody knows what God Save the Queen should sound like. Yeah. And they don't care the fact that I've done an arrangement for the orchestra and that I'm playing, you know, to a certain extent off the cuff, the beginning and the end. They don't care that it's the beginning of the whole show and everyone will hate me if it goes wrong.
I'm sure they won't.
Yeah, they would have done. Yeah, and I would have hated myself. I probably would have jumped.
A bit extreme, but...
Well, a little too extreme, maybe. But you know what I'm saying. And it's on tape, it's on record, you know, and it's on DVD. You can see it happening live. And there's one note in there which just starts to die, and it still makes my stomach go cold. Because if it had died, it would have really put a hole in the whole thing. And it didn't quite die, it just sustained enough, and I was able to come in with the next note, you know. And the guitar sang for me.
Yeah,
and you know, it was a life-changing moment for me. You have to kind of pray in those situations, whether you're religious or not. You have to kind of abandon your power.
Rationality.
Yeah, you abandon responsibility to a higher power, and that's the only way you can deal with it. Otherwise, you would be a jelly.
Oh, oh dear. Yeah.
Yeah, you have to imagine it. It's you know, pressure is something you have to really adapt to live with.
Yeah. Right, okay, and that was very interesting, wouldn't you say, Bailey?
Oh, yes, very interesting. And one quick thing, what you were saying at the end about the pressure, am I right in assuming this is where the inspiration for Under Pressure came from?
You could say that. It wouldn't be true, because Under Pressure was written a long time before, but, you know, it wouldn't be true of that moment. But, well, I think the true answer is no, because Under Pressure really, lyrically, belongs to David Bowie. You know, we all worked on this song together and we created it together, but he took over the lyrical content and defined what the song was about. And really, the song is about human issues. It's about pressure in everyday life.
Okay.
So it's a good question, and I hope that was a good answer.
Ah, it was.
Yes, well, we all do respect. Right. So now we're going to ask you about... What was your favourite Queen song to help write? I mean, there are absolutely hundreds of Queen songs, I reckon. Are there hundreds? And what's your favourite?
I don't know about hundreds. There might be a couple of hundred, all told. Favourites are hard to define, really. You're asking about sort of creative moments, aren't you?
Creative moments.
Yeah, generally, we were kind of lone wolves to a certain extent, in the sense that we were kind of proprietorial about the ideas that we brought in, and you had to throw an idea into the lion's pit, if you like, into the lion's den, because everybody had to work on it and make it into a group entity. But at the end of the day, the guy who brought the song in normally was the boss in terms of how you end up putting it out. Now, that's the only exceptions to that are things like Stone Cold Crazy very early on, which was truly interactive, particularly between Freddie and me, because the words were all Freddie and the tune was all me, you know. But the other guys brought stuff to it as well. And then much later on, you have something like One Vision, which was, again, truly a group experience by choice. We said, we will create this together. We'll just make it happen in the studio. My favourite moment of all, I think, would be the last track I ever did with Freddie, and it was called Mother Love.
Oh.
And it's on that the last album that we made after Freddie had gone, with what we had left of his performances.
Okay.
And Freddie was saying, look, I can sing today, darling. Just write me some more words, you know, and give me this song. And what he wanted was a song in the spirit of the Chris Isaak Wicked Game song. I don't know if you're familiar with that. It's a very mournful, lonesome kind of song. And he said, you know that song?
No, I'm sorry, I'm not familiar with it.
You can find it out. You can Google it or whatever, you know. But yeah. Freddie heard it and he was inspired. And he said, I want a song like that. So I started writing this Mother Love song. And I based it around, in a curious way, I based it around what I thought Freddie was feeling. But we didn't discuss it. And that's very normal for Queen. We don't say, what's this song about? What are you saying here? We say, okay, let's just let it flow. So I wrote him a few words. He said, write me more words. And so I'm writing words on the back of envelopes. And he says, give me another one. And he down a vodka, prop himself up on the desk, because he's very weak by now. He downs a vodka and he steams into it and slaughters it. And the performance he delivered was just incredible. We did it line by line, verse by verse, and he would do three takes of each. And we got three quarters of the way through, and he said, look, just give me a minute. He said, you know, well, actually, I've come to the end of my present energies, and I'll come back and finish this in a couple of days, okay? So we quit, and I'd already demoed that verse, but he never came back. That was the last moment we ever had together in the studio. So I left it very deliberately on the Made in Heaven album with that demo vocal of mine at the end, because it signifies the moment when Freddie did his last great thing, and I think it is a great thing.
Yeah, definitely.
I think it's a very great achievement for him to do. But anyway,
he just kept going.
Yep.
He loved the studio. You know, I think the studio was a safe place for him.
And
he loved music, and music was his life.
Yeah. As it was part of your life as well.
As it still is, yeah. Big part. In fact, it's the thread which probably keeps me going when nothing else does.
So, yeah. So now we're going to take you back to when you started, those good old days, the old days as they're called. So who got you inspired in your interest in rock music?
Well, you have to picture a boy hiding under the bed covers with a little crystal set and headphones, because he's supposed to be asleep, and he's listening to Radio Luxembourg. And the stuff that came out of Radio Luxembourg in those days was like sort of forbidden fruit. You didn't hear it in Britain. You didn't hear it on English radio. But you could tune in, and the signal would be coming and going like, you know, but you would hear these strains of magic coming through, because it was the very birth of rock and roll. It was the birth of rock music. So you got people like, well, Elvis, Little Richard, Buddy Holly, Rick Nelson. And it's the beginning of guitar music as such, the kind of music where the guitar is a voice. And to me, it was riveting. And I just knew at that moment this was going to be part of my life forever.
Right. So Bailey is now going to ask a question.
And I wanted to ask you, following on from what you just said about how that music first entered your life, if I remember right, the first band you properly formed was or played in was 1984, and that led on to Smile, and then that culminated into Queen.
You're incredibly well informed, aren't you? I appreciate that, thank you.
I think he read up on you.
Very good. So, yes, exactly. Yeah, I started off at school and... well, again, it's a different kind of world that you have to visualise, because rock music was not accepted in the circles I moved in. You know, at school, it was regarded as something like the work of the devil, you know, and you were not allowed to bring an electric guitar into school.
Oof.
So we had to hide behind the cycle sheds in lunchtimes and play guitars with amplifiers. And it was very much frowned upon. You know, people really, like our headmaster, really would equate that with, I don't know, prostitution or something. You know, it would be something that you didn't even want to talk about, you know, and you weren't allowed to have long hair, because long hair sort of signified this kind of degenerate culture that rock was bringing in. So it was a very different situation. I mean, nowadays you can learn to be a rock guitarist in school and university, you know.
Yeah.
But in those days, no. It was about some kind of rebellion, I suppose. But for us, it was just a calling. It was something which was tugging at us, because it seemed to be the way that we could express ourselves.
Yeah.
It's a cord that tugs and never really lets go.
That's right. Absolutely right. It never leaves you. And I I consider us incredibly fortunate because we lived at that time when rock was being born in the 50s. And we saw an incredible panorama of music. And again, I'm saying, you know, you have to visualize a different kind of world, different kind of society, because our parents' music was not our music. Our parents' music was something we really didn't relate to. I mean, now I do, now I understand it. But if you look at sort of Johnny Ray and the Glenn Miller kind of things in those days, and Ruby Murray and Perry Como, you know, it was all very nice and sweet and safe, but it didn't express us. It wasn't anything to do with us. It was like all the kind of emotions which we didn't relate to. We had a desire to break out of the mold that we'd been put in as kids. You know, we'd been dressed up in school clothes and kind of our feet were hammered into corrective shoes, and we wanted to escape. And the music that gave us that escape was rock. It's Little Richard screaming his heart out. It's not Perry Como crooning.
The funny thing is, it's a very similar thing is happening today with us. Me and Tone, both of us as teenagers, we're going through that same feelings of being correctional and hammered into society as it is. And rock music is our only true outlet.
Really? That's amazing, isn't it? It sort of shows that rock music belongs to to the young in heart and mind, I suppose, you know, because it doesn't, I mean, you guys obviously have just as much feel for it as I do. Mm. So it's not about how old you are at any particular point in time. It's about that feeling of wanting to express yourself as an individual, isn't it?
Yes.
So that makes me very happy, and it makes me enormously happy that some of our music can give you that feeling. I mean, it makes me happy that you're here and you want to speak to me.
Yeah. Well, that's very good to hear then, otherwise we wouldn't have a job.
Yes. Quite.
So, this year it's 2015, and it marks the 40th anniversary of the song Bohemian Rhapsody, as it has been widely recognised. Could you tell us about the writing process of the song and how it came out to combine the genres of opera with rock to create the new genre, rock opera? I mean, it sounds like it should have its own opera.
Yeah, well, you know, it's hard to find anything new to say about Bohemian Rhapsody, because we have been speaking about it for 40 years, I suppose, and there is another cusp here, you know, there's an anniversary, so they wanted people to talk about it. But I think you have to understand that there's always an element of tongue-in-cheek with what we do. I mean, some of it has very serious undertones, but there is also a lightness to what Queen did, which I think makes it accessible. So Freddie really wouldn't have called it opera. He would have called it operatic, maybe, you know, the operatic section or the operatic bit or whatever. But there would have been a gleam in his eye. There would have been a kind of glint in his eye saying, this is not real opera. This is just me, darling. And this is just us, darling. You know, it's like we're trying to forge a new place, and we're using elements which we've grown up with, but we're trying to form them into something new and different, and something which again expresses us rather than anything that's gone before.
Yeah,
I mean, the writing process, you have to start with Freddie, because he had most of it in his mind when he came in the studio. He could hear it in his head. And of course, as usual, the group wades in and we all input. So for instance, I say to him, look, I would like to play a solo over a verse. Can we put that in here? So we mark that as part of the structure. Freddie then says, I've got this riff that I play on the piano. Ding, 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 ding. Is that going to work on guitar? And I go, yeah, I think so, but I can do this instead of this. And I can harmonize this, and let me do a guitar orchestra at the end. And Roger goes, well, can I do this kind of tom-tom thing in the middle? So you're working together the whole time, but there is a blueprint in Freddie's mind, and he knows what the spirit of the song is. So he, in the end, will be the one holding the reins when the song is mixed, and he was indeed. Now, in those days, it's all hands-on all the way. There's no computer mixing.
Yeah.
Everything's very manual, very analog. So when we're mixing, all of our hands are on the faders and we're all pushing things up and down as a team. So it's like a performance mixing, almost as much as when you're performing and playing your instruments. You're there mixing and bouncing off each other. And those mixes are precious to me. You know, you could remix it now because we still have the multitracks.
Yeah.
But there is a magic to that original mix, definitely, along with the original performance and the original moment when that thing hit the tape.
Yes, absolutely. Okay.
Sorry, was that unnerving?
No.
Can I just ask a question?
Yeah, go on.
I understood that I visited your YouTube channel. I realised you went to visit the observatory in Chile.
Yeah.
And I have to say, like from the photos you took in there, it must have been a very interesting experience getting all up in your construction gear and observing the technology in its full use. Mm. And I've got to ask you, since you started doing science and while you were using premature equipment to learn, how do you think it's evolved? What did you feel about their findings?
Oh, well, that's a big question. It was a big thrill for me. You know, I've always been passionate about astronomy, but I got distracted for about 30 years doing music, you know. Mm. And I actually went back and finished off the PhD, so I am a doctor of astrophysics now. Now, that makes me feel good, but it also opened a lot of doors because people now regard me as something a little bit serious, in a sense, in the scientific community. Mm. So I get to go to these wonderful places. They invited me to Paranal in the middle of the Chilean desert, the Atacama Desert. And it's phenomenal. And, you know, yes, it is. It's a boyhood dream, if you like. You know, I made a little telescope like this with my dad when I was 10 or 11, about the same time, well, a little earlier than the time when we made my guitar together.
Oh, yeah.
And me and my dad made everything together. You know, and to go from this little 4-inch reflector to this vast, huge, the mirror's bigger than this room. And the stuff they do is incredible. They're looking millions of years into the past, because the further you see out into space, the further you are looking into the past, because the light's taken so long to get to us.
Yeah.
So these people are getting pictures now which rival the space-borne telescopes. The most stunning thing for me is this thing called adaptive optics, because I don't know if you're familiar with that term, but my little 4-inch telescope, if you look through that and you see the planet Saturn, you can just about see the rings. Now, if you get an 8-inch telescope, you'll see them a bit better, a bit clearer. If you go on doubling the size of that telescope, sadly, it doesn't get much better. So if you could look through like a 100-inch telescope without anything else, it wouldn't look that great. It would all be swimming around. The reason is that we are sitting at the bottom of a pool of atmosphere, so it's a bit like being on the bottom of a swimming pool with waves on the top. Everything's jumping about the whole time. It's all messed up by the atmosphere, which is why we put the Hubble telescope up into space.
Yeah.
So for a long time, people thought, well, the future is all in space-borne telescopes. But now, some very clever people have introduced this adaptive optics thing. And what they do is compensate for this rippling that's going on. It's immensely clever. So something like 100 times a second, they will be sampling what's going on up there, compensating by actually physically moving parts of the mirror and then applying electronic selection afterwards. So now, instead of seeing this jumbled up, mixed up picture from the surface of the Earth, you see something crystal clear. And so now these people can absolutely challenge the likes of Hubble and the next generation which will go up there. So they are getting phenomenal pictures. While I was there, they actually imaged an exoplanet. So you're looking, you know, we've known that these things exist for quite a while, planets which are going around another sun. They actually have an image of one, you know, which requires incredible precision, incredible acuity.
And are they HD?
It's better than HD. It's seriously high resolution.
Yeah.
So it goes further. People are building bigger and bigger telescopes, and this thing is called the VLT, which is a very technical term. You know what that means? The VLT means very large telescope.
Ooh.
So people are now working on the ELT, and you'll never guess what that means.
Extra large.
Yeah. Extremely large telescope. Yeah. So so you can make up any number of acronyms, you know, but they're getting bigger and bigger. And
they never stop growing.
No, and we are delving right back to the first seconds of the universe's creation after the Big Bang.
Yeah, absolutely.
Science makes it all possible.
Well, yeah. Science makes some things possible.
Yeah, absolutely.
It doesn't make love possible, does it?
Yeah. Anyway, as you mentioned, back in the 70s, you studied for your PhD in astrophysics, and I read somewhere that you were also a school teacher in a comprehensive school. So was it a difficult decision to choose between music and science at that time?
I'm smiling because I didn't make a decision, really.
Oh, then what did you make?
Well, making decisions is not my strong point, but also there was no decision to make. I just, I had to do it to make some money to eat.
Oh.
So basically, I mean, we were lucky in our day. We got a grant to go to university.
Oh, yeah.
You know, these days people have to pay back the money that they give, which I think is scandalous. And I think, you know, education should be a basic human right and should be free and paid by the community. That's another matter. Yeah. But I got a grant. I went through 3 years undergraduate physics at Imperial College. And I got a scholarship to go and do my PhD, but it ran out after a couple of years. So I had no source of income. So I had to teach. And I taught in a comprehensive school in Brixton. I taught maths. And it was great. I just, you know, I'd gone into it for reasons of expediency, but I loved it. Because just seeing these people's faces as the penny dropped on whatever it was, from trigonometry to calculus or whatever, and I saw people actually change their minds about leaving school as soon as they could because they were actually engaged by maths. It was an amazingly rewarding experience. I was quite sad to give it up. I had to give it up after a year, but after a year I'd love to be able to tell you I finished my PhD, but I tried to finish it and failed.
No.
So that's the point where I left the PhD because I just couldn't handle it anymore. But part of that reason was the fact that Queen was just beginning to take off and there was a door opening just a fraction, and we thought if we try to go through now, we may make it. And if we don't, then that door will never open again.
Mm-hmm. And just as it reached the door, it blew open.
Well, it took a while to blow open. You know, to be truthful, everybody thinks it was overnight success, but we kind of tramped up and down on a number 9 bus trying to get a record deal for months on end, me and Freddie. And we eventually got some studio time, but it was on the basis of, oh, you can have a couple of hours in the studio when it's empty, when these guys have gone home, you know, oh, come on, boys, come in and have a couple of hours. So it was really a difficult experience, and we thought we'd missed the boat. Things were happening, like David Bowie played the Rainbow Theatre in Finsbury Park, and that was the kind of ultimate dream for us, and we thought, we're never going to get there. You know, we've blown it. We can't get a deal. We can't get our music recorded. We're going to be just left behind. So it was a tough couple of years being an overnight success.
Mm-hmm.
And then eventually we got a record out and we started to get a following by playing live. And there's this wonderful synergy starts to happen if you're lucky. And we were lucky. You know, we put the record out. It connected with a certain number of people. We were able to play live. And so the two things start to work together. People know your music because they have the record, so they come along and they will support you in a live situation.
Yeah.
And that's the chicken and the egg. You know, the other side is that they come to the show and they enjoy it and they can go away and buy a record. So you can really start building your career, which is what we did.
Yeah, absolutely. As I can probably see, you're wearing a New Horizons badge.
Oh, yeah, I just noticed that.
Yeah, indeed.
Yes. So we're going to ask some questions about New Horizons. Mm-hmm. Could you tell us about your experiences with the New Horizons team during the Pluto flyby?
Well, it was amazing. I nearly missed it because I was here in Britain working to try to defeat the government, who were trying to smash the Hunting Act and make it legal to tear foxes apart with packs of hounds. Now, this is something I feel very strongly about, and we were just about to have a debate on it and a vote on it. So on the day when New Horizons flew past Pluto, I was in London because I had to be. I felt like I couldn't abandon our wildlife. Fortunately, all the action happened afterwards, because when it was flying by, the thing had to be silent. They were gathering information and all the channels were used up, so they were not sending information back. Yeah. I went out there the day after. David Cameron, our fabulous Prime Minister, actually backed down and cancelled the debate and cancelled the vote because he knew he was going to lose. Hooray. So the Hunting Act, at this moment, the Hunting Act is still protecting foxes.
Well, that's good.
Yes.
And hares and deer. So I flew out the day after and they were just beginning to get the data back. And I sat there with these guys thrilled, because I'm like a boy in a sweet shop. You know, for me, this is what I dreamed of when I was a kid. And all these wonderful data are coming back, wonderful pictures. And I had a sort of seminal stereoscopic experience, if you like, because my big passion is astronomy, okay, but there's another big passion that I have, which is stereoscopy in 3D.
All right.
And if you can combine the two, it's a big deal for me. So these pictures were coming in, and I realized that you had whole planet views of Pluto, from just before it went into this sequence of the flyby, and one which was the first image that was sent back after the flyby. So I realized there was a baseline here. So if you put these two pictures together, you ought to get a nice stereoscopic picture of the planet. So I said to these guys, who were all incredibly busy doing their own things, I said, you know, has anybody tried putting these two pictures together? And they went, well, actually, we're kind of busy, and we're doing this, which was all much more important.
Yeah.
And it was much more important. But they said, you know, if you want to have a go, that's fine. So I put them together in a space of about 20 minutes, printed it out, and put it in my stereoscopic viewer, an owl, and I happen to have a few out there, and gave it to them. And they all went, wow. So I got my wow moment out of these guys who had just pulled off an incredible feat by getting, after 9 years, this probe to Pluto. Mm. But I gave them the first stereoscopic whole picture at high resolution of the planet Pluto, which they had gifted me in a way. So yeah, it was a great moment for me. And I spent so much time with them. There's a dust experiment on board as well. They've been gathering dust all the way out there for 9 years, all the way out on the journey to Pluto.
Oh, lovely.
So I'm in touch with those guys, because dust was my subject of the PhD.
Okay.
Dust in the solar system is my subject, if you like.
So no one's going to hoover that up in a hurry.
One grand day, God might just come down and his little maid will hoover it all up. and then he will thank you and all the scientists out there for your contributions.
Well, quite, yeah. I mean, dust is a big deal, though, you know. I mean, it's a funny thing, but, you know, you are dust, I am dust. We are made of the dust.
Everything is dust.
We are dust, yeah. We are stardust, we are gold, as Joni Mitchell said. It's true, because we are made of the remnants of supernovas, and it's blasted out in the form of dust, the heavier elements. That's what's in you and me, and that's what in everything we see. That's what's in everything we see around us.
Yeah. You know,
these lights, this carpet, it's all made out of dust.
We're all an astronomical wonder.
Indeed. And as it says in biblical circles, you know, dust to dust, ashes to ashes, this is the way of things.
Yes, absolutely. So I've been following the images as they go onto the New Horizons website for quite a while now. Mm. What really surprised me is that Pluto has got a massive sheet of frozen substance across it, suggesting possible geological activity. Mm. So what have been the most surprising discoveries for you, and what are your thoughts about it not being considered as a planet and being classed as a dwarf planet?
Well, there's a couple of different things there. Yeah, the big surprise, once we could see Pluto in close-up, was the fact that there's activity at all. It's a long way away, it's really cold, and there are no tidal forces acting on it. It's got a tiny moon. In fact, it's almost a sort of double star system, if you like, double planet system.
Binary.
Yeah, it's a binary system with Charon or Charon, depending on how you
pronounce
your Greek. So what could be powering this kind of plutological activity? And really nobody's been able to answer that yet. Why should there be effectively volcanoes and sheets moving around? What could be powering it? What could be the source of power inside a planet like that? And it's a real mystery. And I think it's wonderful that every time we see new pictures of a body we've never been close to, it's always not what we expect. You look at Hyperion, you look at all the Jovian satellites. None of that stuff was predicted. It's a new book to be read every time. And that's what's wonderful about astronomy, the fact that we know so much, but we know so little. And if our knowledge of the solar system is so limited, my God, how limited must our knowledge of the rest of the cosmos be? You're talking about millions, billions. There's probably a billion suns in our own galaxy, just our own galaxy, which have planets going around them. and there are billions of galaxies. So, you know, our knowledge is just starting. And to me, it's incredible how fast it's advancing. But, you know, we're just children embarking on a long road.
Yeah, absolutely.
I understand that you you had an asteroid named after you in your honor, named the 52665 Brian May. And I got to ask, how does it feel to know you'll be immortalized? You've given your name, and your essentially your essence to a orb of floating rock that holds practically infinite questions and answers.
And could you tell us about the asteroid?
I can't tell you very much about the asteroid. A very nice thing which happened to me when we were talking about Paranel. I walked into Paranel. And I was in a very fortunate position because they didn't have a lot on at that point. They were between projects. So they said, what do you want to look at? And I said a couple of things. And they said, well, strangely enough, we are looking at something which might interest you already. They said, we're looking at your asteroid, the one that's named after you. So on the screen is a star field and you can't see what's what. But then they start saying, well, we're going to take a picture now and in a few minutes we'll take another one. So soon you have a star field which is flicking from view to view, and sure enough you see a little white spot moving across. Deet, 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 deet. And that's my asteroid. So I got to see my own asteroid, which is great. Now, I don't want to make too much of this because I didn't earn this honour. You know, I was kind enough, people were kind enough to present it to me. But it's not something which I sort of fought for and put work into, like the PhD. I mean, I'm probably more proud of having a PhD than having an asteroid named after me.
Right.
But it's a nice honour to have. And it would be great to see it one day, but I don't think I'll ever get out there. It's in the asteroid belt. You know, the main asteroid belt is between Mars and Jupiter, as you probably know, so it never comes that close to us. And it's fairly small. I'm not quite sure what the size of it is. I should check, but it'd be less than a mile across.
Ooh.
Okay. But nice. Be nice to visit, wouldn't it?
Oh, yeah. Although you may want to be careful it doesn't get too close to us, otherwise everyone will be saying Brian May destroyed, like, a quarter of the world.
I don't think that would happen.
Yeah, I'd hate that to be my fault, I have to say.
Anyway, we're going to move on and talk about your efforts in conservation. And we gather that you created your own wood in Dorset. Mm. So what do you intend to do there?
Well, it's an ongoing concern, and it started off with me as a sort of point of curiosity, seeing the fact that we are destroying so much forest, and there is almost no original forest left in Britain, very tiny proportion, and I thought, wouldn't it be nice to restore a part of the forest to what it would have been in primeval times before there were people here?
Yeah.
So I bought this forest, which was forestry land and had been planted, and we had a plan, and we still have a plan, to gradually strip out the formal planting and return it to the original state of the forest. Now, that was enough in the beginning, but it was before I got seriously involved with animals. As soon as I was seriously involved with conservation and with trying to give our wildlife a voice, I mean, it's more than conservation what I do. It's not just numbers. It's trying to secure respect for animals so that they have a decent life, and that's a given. So once I was into that, I suddenly thought, wow, I have this forest here. It should be about animals. What's the use of a forest that's primeval if it doesn't have life in it, if it doesn't have... So we started to think much more carefully about the deer and the squirrels and the foxes and the badgers and all the animals which were living there, and to make sure they have what they need, which is, number one, protection, number two, corridors that they can move as they need to do seasonally. Yeah. They need to have food, they need to have a healthy life. So the whole thing slewed around for me, and it became about what is the population of this forest.
Right.
The next thing that happened was we were looking, you know, we were thinking, how can we improve this? Because it was a small area. And what happened was a number of plots of farmland became available in a ring around my forest.
Right.
So I thought how great it would be, because one of the problems we had was, in a sense, too much accessibility. So, you know, it needed to be more isolated from the modern world, in a sense. So I was able to build a ribbon, and we planted all this farmland with 101,000 trees a few years ago, which is an amazing project. And we got the village involved. which is contiguous with the land. So all those children came out with us and helped us plant those trees, and they will grow up with that forest growing up around them.
Wow.
And it's been a lovely project. We've learned so much. I mean, I didn't know much about it to begin with, but obviously you have to learn as you go along. And you learn what things you can do to secure conditions that are necessary for the flourishing of various kind of species. So you have to have sort of open areas, for instance, to have butterflies.
Yeah.
You have to have protection. You have to have places where badgers can build their sets and not be flooded.
Yep.
All sorts of considerations. And so gradually you build up a kind of picture. And I had we had a number of problems, you know. And when I first took over the land, it was patrolled by these sort of gamekeeper people. And I was advised that you have to have a gamekeeper, and they have to cull the deer, or else the deer will become unhealthy.
Mm.
And I bought the idea for a while, because you know, you can't dive in there and change everything, because you're a lunatic if you do. You have to really observe for a while.
Yeah.
And what happened was, I observed after a while, and I realized that this guy was killing deer.
Wow.
And it was not about the health of the deer. It was about sport for him, and it was about making money for him. So,
and this kind of links into the work which you do for Born Free. So you're obviously going to go on, tell us about that.
That's right. Well, the first thing I had to do was sack the gamekeeper, obviously. So that all went by the board. And I don't buy that stuff anymore. I don't believe that you have to cull to create a healthy herd. And that's a long discussion which I can have with anyone, but it's probably not appropriate here. There are always other ways other than killing. And to my mind, it's normally an excuse. If you say, oh, we have to cull to keep the population healthy, it's an excuse for the fact that people want to kill, because people enjoy killing. Mm. It's a way of life for them.
Well, we don't.
No.
To me, it's inexcusable. You know, the same as bullfighting is inexcusable in the modern world. So it's been a great learning curve for me.
Yeah. So,
and this is why I think it's great that people like you are involved in all this, because you are a great voice among Britain and other countries to be speaking up for animals.
Thank you.
So, anyway, thank you, Brian May, for coming on to our programme. It is an absolute honour to have you on this programme, isn't it, Bailey?
Absolutely, definitely.
Thank you. It's been a real pleasure, and I think you guys do a great job. I'm very glad that I did this.
Thank you. We're very glad as well, aren't we, Tone?
Yes, absolutely. And now, we're going to ask you about how would you get the next generation of musicians, physicians, and conservationists, perhaps, like yourself, to become inspired in those areas?
That's a very interesting question. I think it's about realising that you're a human being as well as a specialist in whatever you've decided. I think the way I was brought up by the previous generation was you have to specialise. So if you're a scientist, you can't possibly be a musician. If you're a musician, you can't possibly be a politician or whatever. But the truth of the matter is, you can be anything you want. And in fact, if you regard yourself as a whole human being, you have to, in a sense, be interested in everything. Why would you go through your whole life with your head in books about astronomy and never look up and see that birds sing?
Mm.
You know, and why would you, be a scientist and discover new molecules but never be aware of music, you know, of Mozart, or whatever it is, you know. So, you know, I think my message would be a whole person and allow yourself to be interested in everything and participate in everything and pursue excellence in every direction you can, because out of that, I think, comes greater understanding. If we're all specialists, we don't even speak the same language. You know, if you look at someone who spent his whole life in microbiology, he will find it very hard to speak to someone about the planet Pluto,
for instance,
you know, and likewise, because they become so specialised in their language. So I think it's great to keep an interest in everything. And, you know, and of course, one of the great things you have to be interested in the end, and I fought shy of this for most of my life, is politics. You know, I always thought, well, politics is done by other people. They can take care of it. Why should I do it? I realised at the age of about 60 that if I don't do it, it won't get done as well as it could be.
Yeah.
I realised that it needed someone to come in there who didn't have a money interest, who didn't have a career interest, who purely wanted a better world, and in my case, a better world for animals. So I think that would be my message. Keep your eyes open and realise that you have a voice.
Yeah.
You can take in everything. You can learn everything about everything around you, and there are countless wonders in this wonderful planet that we live on and in the universe we live in. But in the end, you have an opportunity to use your voice to change things around you for the better.
Yes.
And the time will come where you can use that voice.
Well, that was very true and strong message. So thank you, Brian May, for coming on to the programme again. So it's goodbye from me, Tone.
And from me, Bailey.
And from me, Dr. Brian May, your interviewee on this occasion.
Yes. Thank you and goodbye just now.